And hi everyone, I'm Naomi. I'm the music publisher for Collins, and I have the joy of looking after all our music resources, both printed and digital. We have a wide range of material in the music list, mostly centred around the musical learning of primary age children. We are delighted to have with us today Sue Nicholls, who is one of the UK's leading music education experts. Having taught in schools and EYFS or early years settings as a music subject leader, she is now in high demand as a music education consultant, delivering CPD workshops and training for teachers and teacher trainees. Her specialism and passion, as you will see, is the support of generalist teachers, and she has written and contributed to numerous Collins resources, many of which are designed to be used by teachers who don't necessarily have a musical background. In today's session, Sue is going to share with you 10 top tips for teaching primary music that you can start applying in your own practice straight away. Some tips reference materials from Collins resources to help illustrate best practice, and many of the songs will be shared with you after the event for you to use in your own settings. As I'm sure you all know, one of the best ways to learn is to do. So we're both hoping that you'll join in with as many of the activities as possible, as directed by Sue, safe in the knowledge that there are no cameras or microphones where you are. Without further ado, I'll hand over to Sue.
Hello, everyone. Really lovely to be with you for this music webinar. We hope that these 10 top tips will help you deliver music with greater confidence, using best practice approaches, and perhaps trying out some of the musical resources and ideas that you'll meet today. So, tip one, always warm up before singing. Well, why do we warm up? Like any PE lesson where warming up is considered a necessity, we warm up the body as a careful preparation for singing, because singing engages the whole body, from the soles of your feet to the top of your head. It's not restricted to lungs and throat. Physical warm-ups get children standing up, loosening and moving muscles after desk work, and improving posture. This warm-up chant celebrates some of the wacky 60s dance crazes, so it's a bit of a history lesson too. Normally, children would take on the responses, but I'll say both parts today, leaving you to concentrate on your best dance moves. Here we go. Can you really dance? Can you show me how? Can you dance much better than a three-legged cow? Can you do the twist? I can do the twist. You're just so cool, it can't be missed. Can you do the shake? I can do the shake. It's the shakiest shake you could ever make. Can you do the crawl? I can do the crawl. Can you swim? Can you swim to the swimming pool wall? Can you do the mashed potato? I can do the mashed potato. You can mash it now or you can mash it later. Can you surf the wave? I can surf the wave. It's a dance that you do when you're feeling brave. Can you really dance? Can you show me how? Can you dance much better than a three-legged cow? I'm sure that was magnificent. The vocal folds need gentle preparation for singing. One way is sirening, letting the voice glide up and down through different pitches, using a wide range of notes. Now, with me, hold an imaginary tennis ball in one hand, ready to throw it high in the air and watch it land, letting your voice follow the ball's journey through the air, rising and falling to the sound ooh, like this. Ooh. Have a go. Are you ready? Ooh. Here is a key stage one echo chant called Sound Parade. It features sirening and other vocal sounds too for the children to copy. Please join in with all the echoes.
Sound parade, sound parade. Copy my sounds in the sound parade. Whee!
Whee!
Mmm!
Mmm!
Sound parade, sound parade. Did you copy my sounds in the sound parade?
Another very accessible vocal warm-up is the Banana Song, a popular number from Music Express with just three notes and silly actions, making it a safe warm-up for the voice. Please copy each sung phrase and do the silly actions.
Banana slice, banana slice, banana slice, slice, banana mash.
good fun. Another function of warming up is focus building, seizes children's attention, waking up their responses and establishing you as the leader. This music express focus builder keeps everyone on their toes and their heads and shoulders and their knees, and it's sung to the familiar tune that I've just referenced so subtly, and there are actions to accompany the singing. So have a little go with me. Your moose, monkey, kangaroo, we've got worm, owl, butterfly and flea. I'm going to sing it and I hope you'll join in. One, two, off we go. Moose, monkey, kangaroo, kangaroo. Moose, monkey, kangaroo, kangaroo. And worm and owl and butterfly and flea. Moose, monkey, kangaroo, kangaroo. Tip two. Always count in when singing unaccompanied songs with young children. When you sing an unaccompanied song with children, you need to think about how to start. Now, here's a song sung to the tune of the Hokey Cokey. So let's sing it together. Off we go. My head's a cardboard box, sticks four legs. Naomi, you are miles behind. If that had been a live performance with all of you joining in, it would have been an utter shambles. No shared start, sung in different keys and at different speeds. You need to give singers a starting note and an indication of the pace or the tempo of the song. Let's think about that opening note, how to find the right pitch. Many teachers sing in the same range as their speaking voice. I'm an alto, and if I use that range, my head's a cardboard box, it would be too low for children to sing in comfortably. Now you could invest in some pitch pipes, which I'm holding up now, a very useful little gadget where you blow into the holes to get the note you require. If you don't have that, a really good strategy is to think of the note you would start on and then climb up a few pitch steps. So my head's a da-da-da-dum, my head's a cardboard box. So you then get a better pitch for children to sing with. You heard me do this earlier just now, and I'm going to do it again, singing one, two, off we go at the beginning to set that pitch. One, two, off we go, my head's a cardboard box. And it really does help children to make a proper start. It also avoids the number three, which many young children associate with go in a race. Now, please join in with this song set to the Hokey Cokey tune after the vocal introduction.
One, two, three, four, off we go. My head's a cardboard box, a cardboard box. Sticks for legs and paper bags for socks. My eyes are made from bottle tops. My tummy is a bin. My mouth's an empty tin. I'm your recycled robot. I'm your recycled robot. I'm your recycled robot. I am your recycled friend.
This song is from the brand new Collins Primary Music Early Years book, in which half the songs are set to familiar tunes to support non-music readers. All of the material will also be available in the Music Express digital resource. When leading older children and adult singers, you can incorporate simple signals. For example, are you ready? My turn, your turn, quieter, louder, and stop. An accompanied song will have a played introduction, but you can use the are you ready as that introduction plays and then indicate the start. Tip three, choose age-appropriate songs. Selecting age-appropriate songs will support progression by ensuring that vocal skills are acquired and embedded at the right level of experience, giving confidence and promoting accuracy in quality, articulation, and pitch. You'll see the characteristics of suitable repertoire for each age group on the slides. We talk about cuckoo notes, the two notes like a cuckoo call, doo-doo, and that interval, that's the term we use for the distance between notes, is found in earlier songs from many cultures. Cuckoo notes are ideal for pitch matching, especially in echo songs, because the leader, or the recording, is modelling this important interval, encouraging children to copy and become more vocally accurate. Tunes for early years usually move stepwise within a small range of notes like this, to suit their developing voices. Listen and join in with the echoed lines in this song, Growing Up, from the new early years publication. And you'll notice that the tune is made up entirely of stepping notes with one or two cuckoo notes at the ends of phrases.
I'm growing tall, tall as can be,
tall as can be,
tall as a house,
tall as a house,
tall as a tree,
tall as a tree.
When will I stop?
When will I stop?
Growing so high,
growing so high. Don't stop.
I'll touch the sky.
I'll touch the sky.
At each stage, the material can be a little more challenging, with greater intervals or pitch jumps, a wider range of notes, more rhythmic interest, dynamics, that's quiet and loud, and changes of pace or tempo. Here's an example of a key stage one song from Big Red Barn, from Collins' Sing, Play, Learn series.
There were 10 cows munching on grass, 9 sheep doing a dance. They did the hokey-cokey and they turned around, and that's what it's all about. Hey! Down on the farm in the big red barn, the singing and music and fun. La 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 la. Down on the farm in the big red barn, the summer party's begun.
You can see that by lower primary, singers have already made quite a vocal journey. Pupils begin to sing in harmony, beginning with 2 parts and extending to 3 in upper juniors. Parts are learnt separately and then combined when each line is secure. Children can tackle rounds such as Frère Jacques or London's Burning, because singing in harmony requires more sophisticated listening skills in order to keep the parts in tune. Enjoy listening to this lively part song, Don't Wake the Baby. So the songs you choose are crucial if you're going to develop your singer skills and experience progressively, building on each stage to develop technique, good listening, and ensure confident vocal performances. Tip 4, have the best quality percussion that you can afford. Here are 5 slides showing examples of varied and good quality percussion. The first slide shows pitched percussion, instruments that play notes rather than sounds. You can see a wooden xylophone, a metallophone and glockenspiel with metal bars. There are chime bars and handbells and boom whackers. These are plastic tubes which produce notes when tapped on a surface. The second slide shows tappers. These are percussion instruments that are struck either with a beater or by a hand. These tend to have crisp, clear sounds. The third slide shows scrapers, percussion which has a corrugated surface which gives that distinct sound. and also shakers, which contain rattles, such as seed cases or beads. The fourth slide has images of ringers, including bells of all kinds, triangles, and other metallic instruments that reverberate. The slides don't show all the percussion available, but do include instruments from many cultures. The final slide shows some recycled, found, and junk sound makers. These are useful and cheap to collect and make, and give early years children additional opportunities to explore sounds. Remember that body percussion is another set of sound makers to include in your music making. If you remember to bring your kitchen utensil to the session, these found items also provide useful percussive sounds to augment your instrument collection, and you'll be able to use these in a few minutes. Tip 5, use the correct vocabulary. The interrelated dimensions are the building blocks of music, so it's useful to have a child-friendly way of explaining these key words. High and low notes and stepping notes we talked about when we were looking at early year songs. Some are next door and some jump. As children become more experienced singers, the jump, the interval between notes, can be greater. Duration. Now, this is one that teachers often confuse because it deals with pulse and rhythm. And I'm going to give you an analogy I use when I'm training teachers. Think of pulse as driving along the motorway at 70 miles an hour because the police car is just behind you. And every time you pass a lamppost, you are passing at the same interval. And that could be your pulse. Think between those lampposts of all the flowers and possibly litter, I hope not, but all the patterns of what's growing between them. Those could be envisaged as the rhythm which fit between and against the strong beats. Texture. If you were a bassoon player who wanted to infuriate the neighbours, you could lean out of your bedroom window and play by yourself with a very thin texture of one sound. If everyone else in the cul-de-sac opened their windows and played their instruments, the layers would become thicker. And long pieces of music will have very varied texture. If the harp is going to play a solo in a symphony, the other players become quiet or don't play at all. It's a variety of texture of layers. Timbre is the different qualities of sounds. For example, a bell will be resonant, silvery, metallic. A drum might be dry, a guaro, scrapey and corrugated. They all have different qualities that children need to experience in order to choose the instruments that they're going to play in their compositions. Dynamics, loud, quiet, getting louder and quieter. We use the term quiet in music, not soft. Soft is fine to describe a fabric in design technology, but in music, we use the term quiet. Dynamics also embraces the term silence. Tempo, fast and slow, getting faster and getting slower. A marching band will go at a very strict tempo, otherwise they'd fall over each other. But if you think about hymns or carols or those sort of songs, often the last few bars are sung at a slower pace, just to give it a sense of ending. And structure. This is how the music's arranged. You might have echoes, which we've experienced today, verse and chorus, a call and response, a question and answer song. These are the kind of structures that primary children will need to be used to. Tip 6, listening actively to a wide range of music. Listening to music is a far more enriching experience if the listening is purposeful or active. So always ask pupils to listen out for a particular feature. That might be a rhythm, the entry of a new instrument, a change of speed or dynamic. Each of these can act as a listening anchor. The piece Rippling Rhythm has a distinct 30s flavour and a very definite structure made up of different sections played by clearly identifiable instruments. Here's the score. That's the word we use for music that's written down with symbols. It's from Collins' Listening to Music, age 5+. And it invites children to work out by listening which symbols to slot into the blank sections. See if you can identify those missing parts as you listen to Rippling Rhythms.
Thank you.
that's a great piece. Now, here's the complete score. Did you manage to slot the right pieces in? Now we come to Vaughan Williams' wonderful March of the Kitchen Utensils, another great listening piece. There is a very strong and emphatic beat, as you'd expect in a march, and I'd like you to mark that beat, tapping with your kitchen implement or your hand as you listen. These strong beats come in groups of eight, so count these in your head as you play. But at the same time, be super clever and listen out for the moments when a sudden loud sound jumps out of the music and see if you can identify on which of those eight beats this occurs. Here's a clue, it's not always the same beat. Do you agree it was the alternate seventh and eighth beats? Excellent. You can use this piece as a springboard to creative work by providing spoon symbol cards, white for quiet and red for loud, and a grid of eight boxes to place them in. Invite children to compose their own dynamic pulse patterns and perform their pieces. In this score, the red spoons signifying the loud sounds fall on the second, fifth, and eighth beats. Like this. 5, 6, 7, 8. Quiet, loud, quiet, quiet, loud, quiet, quiet, loud. Let's play this score together. We'll play it four times. I'll give you a count in, so find your utensil or play with your hand. 5, 6, 7, 8. Quiet, loud, quiet, quiet, loud, quiet, loud, quiet, quiet, loud, quiet, quiet, loud, quiet, loud, quiet. Quiet, loud, quiet, quiet, loud, quiet, loud, quiet, quiet, loud, quiet, quiet, loud. Tip number 7, encourage creativity from the start and throughout their primary school life. Providing opportunities for inventive music making throughout the primary school is essential if we are to nurture and sustain children's creativity and promote the growth of learner agency. In the early years, encourage children to make up accompaniments to songs. They won't necessarily match the pulse, but the activity invites listening and exploration of sound. Please improvise an accompaniment on your kitchen utensil, pencil, or body percussion, and play along to this little song about Chinese food. Yummy, yummy, yum cha. I am playing my noodle shaker.
Chashu bao ha gao.
When pupils are older and have a more sophisticated rhythmic repertoire, they can identify and follow a rhythmic phrase and make more considered musical choices. In this enticing medieval piece called Shirazula Marazula, I really enjoy saying that, children have the choice of following either the constant pulse or the little repeated rhythm pattern on their chosen instrument. So listen for a few seconds and then play along to one of those patterns. Fantastic. Using unconventional approaches to composition opens pupils' eyes to new possibilities. Paper and card produce many sounds. And to give you a very simple demonstration on this paper plate, which has a huge repertoire, for example, I can tap, I can scrape, I can flap, I can flick, I can play the grooves, I can snap, can even tear. Watch this amazingly inventive performance of card and paper sounds recorded and layered to create a piece. Unfortunately today the sound isn't as loud as we'd like for this demonstration, but be assured it is the correct volume in the scheme. On this slide, you can see and hear an activity from Music Express inspired by that performance, with a score made up of layers of sounds using the timbre of paper manipulated in different ways. Pupils are invited to create their own grooves too, devising and laying rhythmic patterns. There are many ways to foster musical creativity, exploring sounds, choosing instruments, revisiting compositions to change an effect, writing lyrics, responding to different stimuli, such as an image, a poem, or a story. Tip 8, plan your lessons with a clear structure. Planning lessons around activities that link musically will always make the experience more meaningful. For instance, a warm-up, such as the one we did earlier, Can You Dance, could lean to a main activity focused on dance, choreographing and performing steps to Shirazula Marazula, another opportunity to say that wonderful title, incorporating that rhythmic feature with stamps or claps. And this could be followed by listening to a slower waltz piece, say Moon River, and asking children to identify the differences in the tempo, the dynamics or instruments, and then end up with a song that has a different repeated rhythm, such as Hilangali Rider, Hilangali Rider. It's always good practice to plan clear outcomes, but of course, if your approach is truly creative, remember that some lessons can grow in different directions and unintended outcomes are very interesting. The Music Express lesson plans contain those sorts of ingredients, and here's an example for you to see. Tip 9, keeping assessment simple. Assessment in music should be manageable and useful. Remember that the best assessment always happens informally when you engage in conversation with children. The most straightforward formal assessment is made by looking at the learning objectives in a unit of work, and then think of your children's achievements at three levels: those working at expectation, those working towards expectation, and those children working beyond. In addition to that type of assessment, try and capture footage of the first lesson of a unit where everything is new and unfamiliar, and then film again at the end of the unit, showing achievements that will demonstrate progression. Keep any children's scores to complement your bank of evidence. The Music Express assessment sheets adopt this three-tier approach, as you can see. Tip 10. Attend CPD whenever possible to build knowledge, understanding, skills, and confidence. Regular CPD is important for all teachers, providing opportunities to hear about updates, access new approaches, look at ideas, recent publications, and will give you a refreshed outlook on music making with children. It also builds confidence to enthuse you and give you courage to try out new ideas. So everyone, congratulations. You've ticked one CPD box by attending this session. Thank you very much.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Sue and Naomi, for that brilliant presentation. And thank you so much, everyone, for watching. I hope you got something out of that. As I mentioned at the beginning of the webinar, before we get started on the question and answer session, we will be sending everyone who attended the webinar recording, so you'll be able to pick up on everything that was said today. And also we'll attach a certificate and some of the resources that were used during the presentation. Also, we've had a few questions based around the Collins resources. One person has asked, are they readily available for order? And yes, they are. As you can see on the screen there, we've got our email address, collins.international@harpercollins.co.uk. If you want to get in touch with us directly there, we'll be happy to help you. Another question that we had is Music Express still available as a subscription? And again, yes, that's correct. Get in touch with us and we'll be able to sort that out for you if you're interested. Okay, brilliant. So moving on to the questions. As and when you can think of any, please do type them into the box and we'll answer them. So we'll get started with the first one. Someone has asked, are there music scores for the songs that you were presenting today?
Naomi, that's your department, really.
Yes, it varies according to which resource it came from. So the listening one obviously have those listening scores. The earlier ones come with notation. In Music Express, it varies. So for the younger age groups, there tend not to be a score. But as you work your way through the year groups, they start to use score and notation.
Excellent. And someone did ask if the MP3s come included and if there's diagrams or music sheets, and that's similar to the previous question. And yes, they do come with MP3s, I imagine.
Yes, absolutely. All the audio is included. Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you. One question we have from Katerina, she said, how can we stay connected and informed about further training? I think Sue, you might be able to answer that question.
Well, this is going to sound like a personal advertisement, but obviously I run a lot of courses. They're virtual at the moment. If you're interested in accessing some of this via Charlene, you can contact me and I can send you further details. There is an upcoming course called Moving Towards Music Leadership, which may be of interest to you, which starts around the beginning of May, which is virtual, obviously, as I said. But keep in touch with me and I will keep you informed with the greatest of pleasure.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Sue. We have a question from one person that says, is this applicable for older children as well? So senior school, secondary school students, would you be able to apply what you've discussed here to that level?
I don't know whether you'd like to take that, Sue. Oh, okay, it's me. Okay.
I think a lot of it's
sort of the bedrock of musical learning, and as that extends up into the older year groups, you'd be using a lot of those same principles. So where Sue was talking about how you would tell a group of people when to start playing and when not to start playing, that would carry on up through the year groups. So yes, a lot of it would still be applicable, although the focus of this is more on primary age children, so the repertoire is more focused on that year group. But the principles in general, I would say yes, absolutely. Would you agree with that, Sue?
Yes, I would. I also think that the content of the year 5 and 6, that's upper junior primary, it's a very rich programme, and there's be absolutely nothing wrong with extending that into the years that follow. Here in England we call year 7, year 8, because as I say, there's so much information there and revision is always useful. And because the creative strand is very strong, you could take those creative ideas to make new and exciting activities embedded in those. I think you would find them plenty of material in those upper junior years.
Brilliant, thank you so much. One question I think aimed at Naomi this time, do we have interactive versions or ebooks of the music books that we offer?
So again, it depends on the particular publication or resource. So Music Express is interactive, it's digital, so you can play everything. There are synced up on-screen lyrics. So that's a sort of given, I suppose, in the digital resource. For resources like listening to music, with the listening activities we did there, there are again downloadable resources which are interactive, generally in the form of a PDF where you can just click on the buttons that you need, but that obviously makes things nice and simple for whiteboard teaching or whatever your delivery method is.
Excellent. I think another question about the resources that we offer, is there a programme or resources to teach children how to play an instrument? And I believe we do have that.
Yes, we have quite a few. Well, we've got probably most of your sort of most popular instruments covered. So we have Recorder Magic, which is widely used for group teaching. At primary level, that tends to be the starting point. Similarly, Ukulele Magic, I don't need to explain that. And then we have the Abracadabra series, so that covers all the main orchestral instruments, flutes, clarinet, saxophone, oboe, bassoon, violin, cello, all the strings, brass, trumpets, you name it. So yeah, huge wealth of instrumental teaching resources as well. And Ukulele Magic is included in Music Express, I should mention as well.
Excellent. And as I said before, if you're interested in taking a look at some of the resources, just email me at collins.international@harpercollins.co.uk and we can show you some samples and get them out to you as soon as possible. Excellent. Another question we have is there any material about simple basic sight reading suitable for primary?
So the one publication that comes to mind is Abracadabra Beginning Theory. So it's sort of tagged to an instrumental series, but actually what we found is at conferences, a lot of class teachers are picking it up because it starts from those very basic principles and can be applied in any setting. You can set little activities from it. So that's the one that comes most to mind. But if you're using a scheme like Music Express, the notation and the understanding of score reading is built into the progression. So as we did there, starting with very simple graphic scores where you're just looking at symbols and then building up to more traditional stage notation.
Brilliant. Another question. Composition with instruments is quite scary for non-specialist teachers. Does the Music Express scheme cover composing in simple terms for non-musicians?
Very much so. I mean, as somebody who contributed to the scheme, this was something we felt was hugely important. The thought of 30 children all banging and crashing is enough to make the head teacher run down the corridor screaming into your room. So it is, it introduces composition ideas, not necessarily with every child who uses instruments. Some might use voices or chants, some might use body percussion, but it is very measured and very organised. And I don't think any teacher taking on the Music Express music scheme would need to panic or resign. It would be all right. Everything is very carefully supported and scaffolded. Agreed, Naomi?
Absolutely. Yes, couldn't have put it better.
Excellent. There's a question about Music Express. I suppose that covers the British curriculum requirements for music. Is that right?
Absolutely. I mean, it was meticulously planned by many luminary music educators to cover all the statements and, well, inferences as well of the national music curriculum. It's all there. Every single strand, the performing, the singing, the playing, composing, improvising, it's all there, very cleverly woven. And while I'm talking about the scheme, I think its great strength is that its starting points for each unit are so varied. Sometimes it's a dance, you know, the Shia Razula Mazula. I can't stop saying it now. Or it might be through a chant. It might be through a poem. It might be a picture. It might be a traditional story. So the children come to the scheme with very new and fresh and interesting approaches. It's not kind of prescriptive and dull. It is very interestingly sorted out. And I know Naomi would have said the same, but probably doesn't want to because it's her sort of scheme. But it is. It's very varied and rich starting points.
Absolutely. And actually, just to add to the question around the national curriculum requirements, we do have curriculum mapping documents so that you can clearly see which units focus most on particular aspects of it. Although, of course, with musical learning, it's all happening at the same time in a spiral and all of the parts are interconnected. It just helps you identify if you wanted to focus on a particular aspect of the curriculum, how you might find that. So those documents are available within the resource, but also outside of it in the Collins main documentation on the website as well.
Brilliant. A question about the younger musicians, so age 3 to 5, the little ones. Could you give us some more tips on just how to work with them, Sue? I don't know.
Well, this is very timely because Naomi and I have literally just put out the new early years edition of the Collins Primary Music Scheme. It's red hot, it's literally out in the shops now. And it is, for those who teach early years, you'll appreciate that it's a very holistic approach to education. We don't have lessons necessarily for 50 minutes or 30 minutes, it's all very much woven together. So this scheme starts with 12 starting points or topics or themes, which early years practitioners have suggested to us. And it builds a whole repertoire, not just of music. And as I said earlier, there are songs that are set to tunes we know and new original songs, but also there are stories and there are all the activities that you would associate with early years education. So I'm talking about continuous provision and all the areas of learning provided with an enormous range of activities. So as well as being a music scheme, it is actually an holistic early years complete wraparound scheme. So to the person who's asking that question, rush out and buy your copy now before they all get sold. It is very full. And there's also, Naomi, an online version, is there not?
Absolutely. So all of the content that that Sue's just described, that will be hosted in Music Express as well. And in terms of particular tips for that age group, I'm just thinking about the content that you've written for it, Sue. And there's a lot of movements, isn't there? A lot of moving and responding.
And lovely pieces of music for movement and dance. And yes, and also many opportunities for playing both recycled and found sound makers, as well as conventional percussion. It is a complete music scheme for 3 to 5. So yes.
Mm. Would you, if you were to sort of pull out some key tips from there, Sue, what would you say are the sort of main things?
You mean musical, about the whole scheme? Well, musically, it is just richly focused on, as I say, two kinds of songs, and they all follow those rules. We spoke about the cuckoo notes, the stepping in up notes, the neighbour notes, because we want vocal progression to be emphasised and supported. every activity has musical ideas, tips for learning about, you know, instruments to use and junk sound makers. The listening pieces are really cleverly chosen by Helen McGregor, who's written many Collins books, and she's picked lovely pieces and with all kinds of really interesting suggestions for movement and dance that follow through the whole tropical theme. Everything is linked. That's the beauty of it. And obviously, the most thing to be cherished is children's original responses, not taught responses, but there are some lovely ideas to support learning in music, and as I say, through the whole of continuous provision and areas of learning and development.
Brilliant, thank you so much. And as they said, the book is available now, so if you want to drop us an email, we'll be happy to share some samples with you on that. I guess this is a similar question to the previous one, but it's for a little bit older. So someone has said, do you have any tips on how to teach lower primary students about song structure?
I think you'll find that's implicit in the scheme, but Naomi, there are also some really lovely song book series that you might want to signpost here.
Yes, I mean, I suppose when it comes to song structure specifically, it's there aren't any resources dedicated to that as such, but it's the sort of thing that they're picking up as they're learning different sections of songs. So learning that they may start with the chorus, and they'll understand that the chorus comes again and again, and then adding the verse into that. And most of our songbooks have, you know, that all songs have a structure of some kind. So I think if you're teaching that and trying to communicate what the structure is, I think it's probably just using the language that Sue's covered in this session, and making sure that you're referring to it as you're teaching the song, so that that's being internalized as they're performing and as they're learning. Would you agree with that, Sue?
I was just going to say, the terminology is expressed. They always talk about call and response, question and answer. We also talk about ternary form, you know, ABA structure, that's used quite a lot, or sandwich music, you know, they use generic terms to make it clear. Yes, I do. I think, and the song structure is very clearly explained, because they will say, and here we go back to that phrase. They use words like phrases and about finishing and starting points. It is implicit in the whole repertoire of ANC Black songs. I don't know if we said, but in the Music Express scheme, there is a song bank, Naomi. You might like to talk about that, because there's a lot there, isn't there?
Absolutely, yes. So you can filter by different preferences as well. So you can filter by age group, by style, theme. And actually another thing, in the scheme, in the song player, quite often you can select your different sections. So you can focus on your structure in that way, and you can go from this verse or that verse or from that chorus. So that's, yeah, thank you, Sue. That's another key feature.
Brilliant. That actually leads on to my next question, which is, my school loves singing and they have choirs. What song collections do Collins offer?
Well, they say there's a song for every occasion, and I think the list probably reflects that. So we've got lots of cross-curricular songbooks, so our singing subject series, we have singing phonics, singing times tables, there are history songbooks, languages, singing French, singing Spanish. There are collections for early years, many of which have been written by Sue. So you'll you might want to talk about those a little bit more, but they're really closely intertwined with the other learning that happens in those early years. We've got songbooks that are dedicated to rounds and part singing, so sort of songs more for song's sake than cross-curricular. So pretty much everything you can think of, and in the catalogue they tend to be categorised as either cross-curricular or choirs and group singing. Sue, would you like to talk a little bit about your early years songbook?
I was just going to say that many years ago, when my daughter was just two, I submitted a song to what was then ANC Black Collins, which was a collection of songs set to familiar tunes, because I found on courses, this was long before the days of digitized stuff, that I couldn't get my participants to remember the tunes of new songs. So I pegged them all to tunes we knew, and that went down in something of a storm. And in fact, Collins then produced another six. So there's about six books, all with different focuses. There's Bingo Lingo, which are language songs set to familiar tunes. There's Tom Thumb's Musical Maths, obvious content. There's a PSED one for early years called Help, It's Gone, Naomi. Songbooks. It's a handy band, sorry, the handy band.
Handy band, yes.
And many of those. But also, of course, in the Music Express scheme, there are many songs there that are original songs, as well as those to tunes, because although the familiar tune is a very useful anchor, if you're not a music reader, it really does mean you can tackle a song with confidence. There comes a point when you don't want to sing Bar Bar Black Sheep anymore, however interesting the lyrics. So obviously it grows from that into the scheme with original songs, and those have backings and performance tracks and so on. So yes, there's a huge number of songs there.
Excellent. I hope you all got something out of that. And as I said, in the email that we'll be sending with the recording and the certificates, I'll also attach the a link to our music catalogue, so you can have a browse through that as well. One question we had from someone based in Indonesia, they said, we only have 45 minutes of a music session, I'm guessing per week. How can you arrange the material and games, and how do you go about planning your lessons for that amount of time for younger children, like the lower primary level?
Well, if you use the scheme, it's all done for you. The lessons are approximately, well, they say 30 minutes, but I have to say, having taught them, they go on beyond 30 minutes. They would fit your 45 minute slot beautifully. And of course, it's all sculpted for you. You've got your listening, your singing, your playing. So that's how I do it. If you're doing it sort of freestyle, always have a warm up for 5 minutes, make the main part of your lesson, fill up, you know, your composition, your playing, your performing, whatever, and then have some kind of cool down or cleaner at the end. But you'll find that the scheme actually does it all for you. So I think you'd find that would suit your timescale and your timetable very ably.
And in addition to that, there are extension activities available for each for most of the lessons, actually. So worth taking a look at that as well. If you find that you have time to fill.
Brilliant. Another question we've got is some groups with age 5 to 6. There are a few children with autism. Are there any particular tips how to integrate them in with the other kids when listening to music and singing?
There's nothing specifically published, is there, Naomi?
Well, there are now SEND notes in Music Express.
Oh, yes, sorry.
Which include all different types of additional needs. And there are supplementary notes in About Music Express, which is one of the sections that tells you a little bit more about the pedagogy, the overarching approaches, which can complement the specific notes for each lesson. So that's within Music Express. There isn't a printed publication in that domain, particularly if you've got a group with a range of needs, then that would be the best way of approaching it, is looking at those additional notes and seeing the little ways that you can adapt it to make sure that everybody's able to be involved and participate.
One of the specialist speakers I have on my course talks about, for autistic children, having a little menu, a visual menu for a child to see how the lesson's shaping up. So, you know, an image of, we're going to sing a song, an image of a child holding an instrument. So the child's got a kind of a little timetable, a little visual timetable to work through it, so that they know what's coming. And obviously, I mean, some autistic children need to have ear defenders because they don't like the loud and sudden noises. You might have to make your performance part of the lesson a little more quieter than you would normally do, but I think you'll find there are quite a lot of tips around. I'm sure if you Google special needs or autism in the main school, you would find lots of websites that would help with that. It is becoming a much more common occurrence, isn't it, that we have children with, on the autistic spectrum.
And actually worth just a little teaser, really, I suppose. In the summer, we'll be publishing an SEND scheme, which into Music Express as well, which you'll be able to dip into. So you may want to kind of factor that in alongside the SEND notes.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Naomi and Sue, for answering all those questions. Loads have come through. As you can see, before we wrap up, in the chat box, we have attached a link to our catalogue. So do take a look at that, have a browse. And we hope you find something in there that's suitable for your specific needs. So thank you so much for attending. Thank you very much for presenting and being with us, Naomi and Sue. Really appreciate it. And do check out our webinars for upcoming at collins.co.uk/webinars. Thank you so much, and have a nice rest of your day, everyone.